Oh, okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, especially youth. As you may know, right, corruption is rampant in this country. So it's very difficult to talk about corruption because you will be followed. But anyway, you don't have to worry because most of the special branch are very busy following their politician. So no problem. You can WhatsApp. Nobody knows. But we really need you as a youth, right? Because my generation, I think, already spoiled. Beyond repair. So we really need you one day when you become the leader, or also, and also if you are a public, right, make sure that you do not give corrupt. So meaning to say, if the government servant were to ask you, I think it's a high time for us to say that, hey, you are government servant, you are servant, we pay your salary, right? We have to go to that stand, right? Must tell them, don't give. But the problem, some do not give, but most of them give. There's a study, you know, by E and Y that a question was asked, if there is an economic downturn, the company is willing to bend the rule, you know, to get business. 54% of Malaysians say yes, but 29% in Indonesia say no. No, I mean say yes, but you see, you compare, they are much better than us. Indonesia, Thailand is coming up. They have a good leader with a strong political, with strong and sincere political will. This is very important. Sometimes you got strong, so no point because not sincere. Right. Strong in different ways, no point. So again, I hope that you, Gen Y, one day when you become government servant, politician, not politician, statesman, right? There is a great difference between statesman and politician. Politician thinks of next elections, right? Statesman thinks of next generation, correct? So we need you. We need you to take care of my children. No, my grandchildren, right? It's true, right? So again, that's why I think it's very important for TI also to get involved with the youth, because you are the future of this country, right? And again, since I have some speech there, I think I would like to read, right? Welcome to TI Youth Integrity Debate 2016. It is my great honor to be here today to witness such an event as TI Malaysia works harder to engage the youth more and more on addressing corruption cases. This year's debate will focus on issue of freedom of speech under attack in Malaysia. Critics are commonly silent, especially Malaysian, right? Through law, suit based on Sedition Act, and you could get the impression that nearly every kind of critic is judged to be seditious lately. Therefore, we ask six Malaysian debaters to debate on exactly this hot topic here today. We are convinced that the debating contemporary political issues is not only everyone's individual human right, but that a vivid exchange of ideas and argument is beneficial and necessary for every democracy worldwide. Pluto used to say, right, he doesn't care whether it is autocracy or democracy, but as long as you put the right person in the, in the right place, this is very important. The youth integrity debate has originally been thought up by our three pioneering youth ambassador last year, Mi Hua Wong, Nicholas Tan, and Ong Chen Ken. They were first brought together when TI sponsored them to attend the TI's first international youth camp in Cambodia last January. However, all three of them are now pursuing successful international career, and it is therefore time for TI to bring up new generation of youth ambassadors, you. Therefore, I want to take this opportunity to invite you, assemble here today, youth, please, to consider to take up this challenge, but also rewarding role. Our youth ambassadors are part of the youth movement for Transparency Asia Pacific, where they will not only receive training, but we will also ask them to implement their own project aiming to curb corruption in this region, especially Malaysia. So if you could see yourself as the future youth ambassador of Transparency International Malaysia, do not hesitate to put your name on the registration form we have prepared for you at our information booth. We need your help, right, to fight corruption. Not our generation, but you. This is very important. Alongside our inspiring youth leader are the six champion debaters participating today. Top of the range in the Malaysia ever-growing debating scene, all six have agreed to take part in this event, which aim to provide a platform for the youth to openly aim and engage on issues pertaining to corruption and freedom of speech in a safe environment. Today is also about creating a dialogue between generations. We, as the more matured generation, which is cannot repair, should be inspired by today's generation who are taking it upon themselves to talk about this issue in a critical, balanced and engaging manner. In 2014, TI published a report on integrity crisis in the Asia-Pacific. The finding shows that 4,000 young people surveyed over three quarters of the young people admitted they would use corruption to gain advantage. That means we conducted a survey in Asia Pacific. 66% stated that if they have power, if they have opportunity, they are willing to get involved in corruption. In Malaysia, a survey was conducted by the MACC and UKM in 2003. So they also agreed when they have power, when they have opportunity, they are willing to get involved in corruption. And just imagine now, the survey was conducted in 2003. Now they are in the system. Either they influence our generation or our generation spoil them. So this is very important. This is crisis of this is called crisis of integrity. Integrity crisis. It is not only happened in Malaysia, but the whole part of the world. But of course, I'm so sure that Malaysia is one of the worst. Huh? Again, we all know the role we need to play. We should be inspired and follow the example set by youth leaders today. And before we start the debate, I would like to give a special thanks to our sponsor for today's event, Jeffrey Chia Foundation. Wow. Thank you very much, sir, because it's so difficult to get donation. Do you know that your contribution is taxable, you know? But donation is not taxable. So we have to change the definition from contribution to donation. They tax us, you know? Yeah, TI is... We have to pay tax. No, it's true. It's not a joke. Yeah. Again, we want to specifically thank two persons from the foundation, Miss Jane Poh, correct, right? And Miss Angela. Thank you very much. Once again, to you all, thank you for coming today. If I compare to last year, this year, I think the crowd is much better. Thank you very much, Sunway. Thank you very much, youth. Please fight against corruption. Please make sure that my grandson, our grandson, will be... living in a better place, and we share the wealth that we have. I'm sure if we share the wealth that we have, we can be a power better than Singapore. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this year's Youth Integrity Debate. My name is Mahdev, and it would be my pleasure to be Speaker of the House today. We have with us six of Malaysia's finest debaters that have gathered to debate on the motion this House would ban private settlements in defamation suits. Now, just for the benefit of the audience, I'd like to give some background on the motion. A defamation suit, in definition, would compose of any form of communication that is deemed false and that which causes direct harm onto an individual. Now, a private settlement would be a formal agreement between involved parties that take place outside of court, and that could include some form of compensation. Debating this motion will be the six debaters who, over the years, have placed Malaysia on the world map when it comes to competitive debating. We have with us today Mr. Patrick Cheang, whose name was used in naming Patrick Star of SpongeBob, and he himself is a ESL category of Australs winner 2015, a grand finalist of Nationals 2014. Along with him in the team would be Ameera Natasha Moore, who has friends that come over to her place just to play with her 13 kilos cat. And she extends that invitation to all of you as well. Her achievements include UADC Champion 2015 and Cambridge Women's Debating Championship overall best speaker. The final member that will compose of Team Government is Amrit Agastia, who does not believe in the existence of 13 kilo cats. She is the overall best speaker of the Malaysian Debating Open 2016 and was part of the history-making WSDC team that brought Malaysia to the quarterfinals of the World Schools Debating Championship. Ladies and gentlemen, Team Government. In team opposition, we have Ms. Jainah Jaafar of UITM. She is the ruler of Catalonia, a place in which the citizens are mainly cats. And her achievements include UADC 2015 grand finalist and ABP 2015 top 10 best speaker. Joining her will be Mr. Don Siron Pereira, who apparently is the winner of all online quizzes related to the famous sitcom Friends. He has another passion. He's the head coach of the Malaysian World Schools Debating Championship team and has led four separate teams to winning four Asian titles over the past few years and was also part of the team that led Malaysia into the quarterfinals of WSDC 2015. The last debater that will be forming the opposition team is Deborah Woong, and she does not believe in fun except chup fun. Now, Deborah is the champion of the English as Second Language category of Australs 2015 and is also champion of the Ministry of Higher Education Cup. Ladies and gentlemen, team opposition. As you can tell, this debate complies with the Asian parliamentary format, with speeches being 7 minutes long and points of information allowed to be made at the first and sixth minute. Now, the timekeeper would ring the bell at the first minute to indicate the beginning of all points of information and at the sixth minute to indicate the end of all points of information. At the seventh minute, a bell will be rung once again to indicate the end of speeches and once more at the seventh minute and 35th second. There will be 4 minute reply speeches at the end of the debate, first from the opposition, followed by the government side. Now, before we proceed to the actual debate, might I remind the audience to please keep all electronical devices on silent and only exit the auditorium in between speeches and not during speeches. Ladies and gentlemen, to start off the debate, I would like to invite the Prime Minister of Side Government.
Testing 1, 2, 3. Can everyone hear me? Ladies and gentlemen, justice is sometimes unjust. It favors the disproportionately rich, disproportionately famous, and also the disproportionately powerful in the state. We believe that it's high time we stop this. More often than not, these individuals are allowed to hide behind their veil of power in order to clamp down on the rights of people like you and I. People who belong to this society that believe that just and law is supposed to be one that fits for everyone. And that's why, ladies and gentlemen, SAC government is proud here today to promote on the motion we would ban private settlements in defamation suits. We think that Dave gave generally a good definition just now in his speech, but we're going to clarify again what do we want in this debate. We believe that when we talk about private settlement, it's also known as out-of-court settlements. That means it is a private agreement which, without adjudication by the court, it is not going to be written in the court documents, and also it comes with a non-disclosure agreement. That means both parties, the plaintiff and the defendant, cannot mention anything about this outside to any other parties besides the two of them and also the lawyers. We think that this is the foundation and this is a clarification that needs to be understood in order for you to understand most of the harms that site government is going to present to you. But secondly, let's talk about defamation suits. Obviously, we're referring to the civil suits that happens, for example, between a plaintiff and a defendant. Putting it in layman's term, it means, for example, like a corporation or a politician or maybe anyone who is actually suing another person for any acts of defamation against his or her name. So it might include, for example, me claiming that there are certain forceful acts about a certain individual, or it can be, for example, me claiming that certain business entity is carrying out certain malpractice, and this is all premise in order for us to carry out defamation suit. So the stance coming from side government is simple in this way. We think that yes, while there are benefits and disadvantages to both allowing it to be carried out of court and also disallowing it, we feel comparatively the necessity of our ban into not allowing out-of-court settlements far outweighs the out-of-court settlement that they want to propose. Three issues for me today. Number one, I'm going to be talking about why is it important to normalize the trial process to the poor and also society. Secondly, why is the court verdict explicitly important and why do we need to hear a verbal confirmation from the judge? And thirdly, that even if the verdict is unfavorable and it rules and promotes the idea of it's still going to side with the powerful, we think that the byproduct, which is information that we get from this form of lawsuit, is ultimately important for us to actually have some form of traction in the end. I'll take you in a while, yeah? So comparatively, understand that this debate, due to the sheer complexity of defamation suits, we are broadly going to discuss on three different types of suits. So firstly, obviously, we have, for example, the normal society taking action against powerful and influential entity. Secondly, on the entity themselves clamping down on the rights by counter-suing the individuals. But also thirdly, broadly speaking, on, for example, a class action suit between a community and also an entity. These are all premises that we're going to detail to you later. Before I move into my case proper, sure, I'll take a PY.
There is never a certainty to the outcome of a trial as well as the amount you can get. If a plaintiff chooses to engage in a private settlement, why would you disallow it?
We will argue that more often than not, the benefit that you derive from our side when you put it in a collective good far changes the normative of how people will react and therefore allow you more benefit in the end that is not simply quantified in remuneration and, for example, allowing you to get a small sum of money that ultimately forces you to be able to be subservient to the major form of oppression that's happening in society right now. Let's move into my first argument on why is it important to normalize trial process. Precisely what the side opposition is saying, there's an overarching assumption right now that the minute that a huge corporation challenges you, you're bound to lose, that normal members of society like you and I are never be able to be empowered to stand up against the vast, powerful corporations or conglomerates that exist out there. That's why far too often, we are often being told that if we are given an opportunity to settle out of court, we should do so. We think ultimately that's something that's false because the major logic in this is simple. That if, for example, a corporation is willing to settle out of court with you, that means more often than not, your griefs are legitimate and therefore they will be able to listen and the courts will often adjudicate in the best and fairest way possible anyway. So we tell you that in any instances, there are equal chances for you to also win against this form of powerful conglomerates that you think you never stand a chance again. We need to normalize this idea because far too often in society, we are told to keep quiet, that more often than not, it's okay for us to just be quiet and remain silent and not take any form of suits because ultimately we'll lose. We need to change this narrative that not far too often, the powerful has told us that we should listen to them because they are the ones that provide us with opportunities. They're the ones that provide us with the products that we want from your Apple, for example, to your nasi lemak at the roadside store. These are all instances where we tell you that it's okay for society to voice out the wrongs if we believe that ultimately their rights have been clamped down upon. There needs to be a stop to this form of cycle of oppression that we think are carrying too often. So even if, for example, under their side, you get some form of remuneration or some form of winnings, ultimately, you are still going to be clamped down and the same thing will repeat because there's simply no start to start this discussion on whether or not they are able to actually settle out of court. We would rather be transparent and allow all this information to be shown to the public in order for them to be some form of interest or at least some form of action to solve this form of oppression that's been carried out for far too long. It can only come when we allow people to know of the proceedings. It can only come when the people know that these instances are happening and not simply be swept up by the powerful into, for example, page 43 of your newspaper. Second idea, why is the court verdict explicitly important? It's important for us to actually attach a truth to a certain statement because far too often we've seen in news that an individual decides to take a suit against a certain corporation or a certain powerful influential figure. The next thing you know, within 1 or 2 weeks, you never heard of that news again. Because far too often it's swept under the rug when the powerful decides to pay off and therefore the poor will, because of like what side opposition wants you to believe, think that it's better for us to settle. Anyways, what does this harm into? This, for example, plays a part into actually form some form of ambiguity. And far too often, this form of ambiguity or this form of guilt is going to be associated with the people who are less privileged. That means, for example, even if there's some form of out-of-court settlement, people are going to think that it's because the privileged are the ones that are right, and therefore these people are forced into actually coerced into actually leaving those suits. So even if there are ambiguity on whether or not a certain politician or a certain layman is involved and suddenly the case is dropped, people will always assume that the layman is wrong and the powerful politician is always right. It's time for us to change that narrative as well. But lastly, even if the court and the verdict is unfavorable, why will it be beneficial? Because we get very crucial information that dictates the trend of this certain politician or dictates the trend of this certain corporation, and we can at least use it in future reference in order for us to know whether to associate or disassociate from this certain entity. It's important because once you agree to a private settlement, all this information is struck from the record of your courts, and therefore there's no way for the public to know of all these happenings. We think it's high time for us once again to let this knowledge to be flown out to the public in order for them to make the best decision possible, in order for the public to be best informed. Never been prouder to propose.
Thank you, Patrick. And now to start the case from side opposition, Ms. Deborah Woong.
In today's debate, I'll talk about four things. One, I'll tell you why banning out-of-court settlements are just unfeasible because it overburdens the courts. Secondly, I'll tell you how you minimize the sensationalization of news, which are often harmful for everyone. Thirdly, I'll tell you about time sensitivity, why it's a very important factor to consider. And lastly, because I'm Chinese, I'll talk about money. So, before I go into my arguments, I'll talk about some rebuttals. Firstly, Patrick told you that it's important to normalize court procedures and make it more accessible to the poor. That's not true. But the argument from that side is this, is that the common perception is that average person is likely to lose a court case as opposed when they're going up against huge companies or huge corporations, for example, and therefore we need to change that perception. Unfortunately, it is true that the average person is more likely to lose when they're going up against huge corporations because corporations just have that much more money and a lot of time that they're able to spend to drag out court cases, where the average person, if he or she were to take out that much time, would mean losing time at work, would mean losing time or like job opportunities and may even cost them their livelihood. So, unfortunately, the option of going through a private settlement is especially important, especially for people, most likely the people who are brought to courts through charges of defamation, say maybe your average blogger or say the average layperson, the average person that works in an office, cannot afford going through those long court processes because it directly affects their lives and therefore the option is important. It's up to them to decide whether they want to take on the challenge and to go through because the cause of suing that company is so important to them, but you cannot force them to like always stick through. No, thank you. Secondly, Patrick told you that it's important important that the information about the case gets out because people need to gain awareness. Number one, the moment you go to court, more likely that papers have already published those news anyway. Say, for example, person X is bringing a big company to court and those things are already publicized. We already have information. The question is, how far do we want to sensationalize, do we want to amplify that issue? And we think those decisions is perfectly fine to leave it up to private citizens to decide whether they want to like amplify those information or not. Because if information are really that harmful and actually harms a lot of people in society, more often than not, we have criminal charges that can take care of those problems anyway. Before I move on.
Why is the sensationalization of news more likely in a world where there is a court proceeding with actual evidence and provision of facts?
Because newspapers have no obligation to follow rules such as to not make speculations, right? As much as laws are in place to limit what newspaper can say, as long as it is their opinion, no one can hold them accountable. So newspaper can publish a lot of opinions that we think these companies actually did a lot of dodgy things when that may actually not be the fact, and that hurts revenues of huge corporations, it hurts the workers in those companies, and that's bad. I'm moving, no thank you, into my argument. Number one, why it's unfeasible? If you look at Malaysia, the current rate of judge to population ratio is 2.4 per 100,000. That's an overburden of our system. We have limitations in terms of our budget constraints as well. Every case that you bring to court takes up those resources, and that means the more cases we have, the harder it is for us to mete out justice to people who need it very urgently. That means, like, throughout the 70s and 80s, Malaysia, the court systems in Malaysia are boiled down through problems of not being able to constantly give out justice in time. That's why we, in 2008, Deborah. We have, no thank you, the delay and backlog reduction program. All of this goes to show you that allowing out-of-court settlement is a huge part in the criminal justice, the justice system, in allowing for people to make their own decision. Maybe this thing is not worth actually going through all the processes of in the court, and therefore it's okay for me to take it out of court. That substantially reduces the number of cases that courts have to go through. That means we're much able to give out, spend time more on other important charges that people really want to bring to the court. Number two, the minimization of sensationalization. The thing is this, in defamation suits, often the people who are defamed want to reduce the information to get out as much as possible, because the more people read, even if it's just an alleged charge, it's still bad for their reputation. So the moment that these court cases get out there, it harms these corporations or people or famous people whose reputation are currently being harmed. But allowing out-of-court settlement, by allowing them to just pay off or to settle things outside with the person who have defamed them, that means they can immediately make that agreement, the non-disclosure agreement, like what government said, and make an agreement for the person, the blogger or whoever it is, to take down those blog posts, to take down whatever he or she have said. So that means a mitigation of harm for the person who have been harmed or who have been defamed. Right? So that's about the harm to the person. But what about society? We think generally it's not good that we allow news to go out, especially when it concerns things such as defamation, when it concerns things that may not be true, that may like have a lot of substantial harm to people. When society tends to amp up things like what I told you when I answered the POI just now, when newspaper can just use a lot of opinions to mock, or to make fun, or to defame a lot of corporation, that's not a good thing. But thirdly, I want to talk about time sensitivity. A lot of times, you need to be able to allow corporations or people who are defamed to settle that problem as soon as possible, because the longer those statements of defamation are out there, the more it harms their reputation. Comparatively, going through an out-of-court settlement is much, much faster than it is going through a court process. That's why in all defamation cases, the first option that lawyers will try to go through is to have an out-of-court settlement, because it's so much faster, because it actually helps solve the problem that the defamed person cares so much about. Lastly, about money. So when you look at cases such as when Dato' Tan Sri Vincent Tan was sued a newspaper, a media corporation, and get a lot of money in return, those are cases where we think if brought to court, court might not be able to adjudicate exactly how much or how fair the award or the compensation can be. We think it's much more likely or much more feasible or much more appropriate for these people to just have their negotiations out of court, because courts are sometimes averse to giving huge amount of funds to people, because reputation is something that is so hard to gauge. That's why private settlement is so much better. We're very happy to oppose.
Ladies and gentlemen, a lot of Deborah's arguments were not recognizing the fact that a lot of the times when private settlements are allowed, a lot of the times it may not necessarily be the inherent choice of that individual who is the current plaintiff trying to forward that case. A lot of the times the reason why they are pushed into taking private settlements is because private settlements create an avenue for big corporations, big privileged rich individuals to intimidate you into taking that plea rather than going to court, when in fact there is a possibility that that individual could have easily won that case and the law could have been on their side. Or number two, in the event that this individual wants to actually go to court, a lot of the times their friends and family tell them, don't be stupid. Take the money and let this end here. We think in actuality, you are not necessarily fighting for the freedom of the choice of this individual to obtain valuable closure that would bring a verdict to say that this individual is innocent. That is something that you don't allow. In my speech, I will answer three questions, and all of my rebuttals and responses will be integrated in these questions. Number one, are we really limiting the choice of these individuals or interfering with their inherent choice? Number two, who better minimizes sensationalization? And number three, how do we help the small guys in the future of defamation cases, which I might point to you was not even a consideration coming from side opposition. Number one, are we really interfering with the choices of these individuals when it comes to deciding whether or not they want a private settlement? We don't necessarily think so. Because number one, we think that, like I mentioned before, a lot of the time private settlements allow for big corporations to come and intimidate. Because think about it. Logically, a lot of the times why corporations feel that there is a bigger gain for me to give you a compensation through a private settlement rather than going to court is because they realize they probably would lose in court. Because if they knew that it was very easy for them to win in court and it would have cost them less money, they would have seen you in court. We think in this scenario, it means that you allow that individual to be intimidated into taking that money regardless. But it also means that it's not just in a situation where it's a big corporation now intimidating that individual to take their money, but it's also in the reverse, where an individual is trying to tell the society that, say for example, a corporation is corrupt or a politician is corrupt, and that politician sues them. That politician is more likely to tell that individual that if you go to court, I will make sure that I drag this out so badly that you won't be able to get proper justice. When in actuality, we could have defended that individual, but because of the position of these privileged individuals and entity that intimidates the smaller person, that smaller person feels the pressure to pay that settlement regardless, even if it comes at such a huge amount. So we don't necessarily think that you are assisting the individual choice of this individual to get closure for himself. But secondly, and the most shameful part of it, is that I don't blame friends and family if they are scared of the idea of this individual going to court. But the reality is, when corporations and politicians and other privileged individuals are given this avenue to put private settlements as an option on the table, it means that you push friends and family to pressure that individual to say, take that settlement or pay that settlement rather than going to court. So I question the extent of how genuine your individual choice really is. No. Number two.
Will this actually minimize sensationalization? They told us the point at which you bring this to court, it will become more blown up in newspapers, and that's not something that we necessarily want. First response is that we think that these opinion-based articles that Deborah was talking about would happen anyways. The only difference is that it would happen worse in your world. Why? For several reasons. Number one, there is no court verdict to actually verify the sort of truth towards that opinion or to give it legitimacy. We think that you allow individuals to hijack and like have a badminton game of like or a tennis game or whatever sports you like, really, about like this idea going back and forth and not really allowing closure and the resolution of what opinion truly matters. No. Number two, we think in our world, even if there are opinions going back and forth, at least that opinion is based on some form of legitimate evidence or information that you would not have gotten had it not been for the court trial. Deborah says, but that's not true. In defamation cases, you would have already have the evidence, which is the article. But there are so many other byproducts of a trial that may not occur in your world. What am I talking about? Things such as realizing what are the arguments of the lawyers in court. Things such as which jury did they rule out of making a decision in this case. Or what sort of mitigating factors do these corporations usually invoke when it comes to being charged with defamation cases. We think these are sort of things that you don't get to see the point at which you allow for an out-of-court settlement and just allow this sort of like speculative form of opinion to exist. Hold on. Thirdly, we think with private settlements, you allow the rich actually to hijack that sort of conversation. Sure, maybe with out-of-court settlements, you have a non-disclosure agreement to not talk about the case explicitly. But what do privileged individuals who have bigger reach into pockets of society through media do? They act in such a manner that gets broadcasted to give the population reasonable doubt to believe that he is the innocent individual. For example, many politicians, and I won't mention countries, like to talk about the idea how they are being defamed for the fact that they are corrupted. And they try to defend themselves and say that they aren't corrupted. So they opt for private settlements. Even though they don't talk about the case after that private settlement per se, but what they do is they start forming all of these like bodies, like anti-corruption bodies, or donating towards individuals who want to fight corruption, creating the environment that makes people believe that you are innocent. That means you necessarily create a rhetoric and a conversation that oppresses that individual who was trying to point out that you are corrupted, but was pressured into taking the private settlement that politician and that corporation forwarded on the table. Sure.
The overwhelming influences of a powerful corporation does not go away when they eventually go to trial. How does this innocent, really harmless individual combat that in court?
Look, we think that there are it's simply untrue that every time you go to court, the small guy always loses, right? We think that there are times where they can win, when it is clear that this individual is rightfully accused of corruption, that is not necessarily defamation. Maybe we don't have a criminal case to prove a verdict that you actually are corrupted, but it does not mean that the sort of opinions that this individual is writing is necessarily defamatory. Instead, it is like based on some reasonable doubt as to why individuals are likely to believe you are corrupted. But number two, a lot of the times when it's a high-profile case dealing with big, corrupted individuals or big corporations that take advantage of smaller individuals on the ground, it also means that it's a high-profile case that is very much scrutinized, right? Either by the population, either by Transparency International, either by other NGOs or other organizations that wants to ensure that pure forms of justice are carried out in this case. We think that that small guy gets more support structure in our world where friends and family don't pressure him into doing so. There's no room for intimidation from bigger guys, but you also get the added value of having people scrutinize that case to make sure that justice is served. Thank you.
Thank you, Ameera. Now to continue the case from side government, side opposition, let's have with us the Deputy Leader of Opposition.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this point, you have heard a lot of nice-sounding, rhetorically powerful debate terms that did not actually conclude anything. Because what we would argue from opposition is that side government is debating a debate about why private settlements is necessarily a bad thing without tying it to the concept of defamation. It's not enough to argue that poor people will be victimized because They started the debate operating on the premise that there is a bullying process and that victims are often forced. Let's first acknowledge that defamation requires some degree of reputation of the individual that is victimized to begin with. That means it must be a person in a position of power or a person in a position of influence. So we would argue from opposition that smaller guys aren't part of this debate, ladies and gentlemen. So Pak Mat who sells putu mayam in Kampung Baru isn't really a consideration in this debate. We are talking about individuals whose reputations are on the line, individuals who would like to avoid a mess at the point which the option is granted to them. I'm going to be talking about two things. One, I'm going to be talking about the defendants and why we think this option should be given to them. Secondly, I'm also going to be talking about the defendants because we think it is also important to acknowledge that sometimes individuals who have committed a wrong can choose to resolve that wrong at the option that is presented to them rather than one that is forced upon them. But before that, one small point of response that doesn't necessarily fit in. They say right now that families of individuals who are victimized or where the rumor that is started or the person whose statements are made against, it is important because the families will now pressure you and force you to take that settlement. Let's acknowledge that when you have a statement that says Mr. X walking around with Miss Y in front of Hotel 123 looks really happy, published in a newspaper, doesn't sound as bad. But it becomes really bad when Miss Y isn't his wife, when Hotel 123 is a front for a brothel, for example, ladies and gentlemen. So the individual's wife can still be harmed by these statements, can pressure her husband to want to take that settlement to avoid a court trial that is long drawn, something that allows for her friends in the community club to make fun of her continuously, rather than one that acknowledges that it can be a secret, we don't need to talk about it anymore, we think families are also important. So let's talk about plaintiffs. No, thank you. The first thing we will acknowledge is that it removes the choice of the plaintiffs. Why do we allow for alternative methods of dispute resolution to begin with? It isn't just about helping courts be expedient, but it's also to provide an option for the victims, ladies and gentlemen, especially because trials are often uncertain. So an individual can win a court trial, but how much money he or she gets from that court trial is different and independent from how much contribution they give to that case. Therefore, we think it's especially important. Let's talk about the small group of people that they were talking about, the poor, right? It's unlikely that the poor will be able to get the benefit that you are talking about because A, they will often have to pay a lot to get to court to begin with, but B, acknowledging the fact that the trial doesn't always go their way or doesn't account for the fact that they want a lot of money, we don't think that the poor are necessarily protected. But what we think is more important is that victims at least get to choose how I would like to engage in this process, ladies and gentlemen. So at least the person can say X amount of money is a lot more important rather than an amount that is undetermined because trials are unpredictable. Secondly, we think it removes additional harm. No, thank you. The sensationalization that Deborah brilliantly talked about is genuinely important. They say, why is it likely that this will happen, ladies and gentlemen? Because, let's acknowledge, people in the real world like to talk about the juicy stuff rather than statistics and fact, right? So you have things like misleading titles in newspapers, for example, no, thank you. Things like X and Y steamy tape because people in the real world are susceptible to things like onion politics and rhetorics that are more juicy or more persuasive rather than factual data, ladies and gentlemen. Everything we do in Malaysia, especially, are things, when we do a particular thing, for example, often it becomes a Zionist propaganda rather than evaluating whether or not something is genuinely an important thing or a good or a bad thing, ladies and gentlemen. Generally, no, thank you. We think that a victim doesn't owe an obligation to other victims for a collective good. So every injury you suffer, be it a physical one or a mental one, is individualistic to you. You went through it alone, you suffered through it alone, ladies and gentlemen. So we don't force and parade you to become the poster child of justice if you don't choose to be that poster child of justice. Jay? That's why we don't force victims of assault to sit in court, face the assaulter, and be a role model to other individuals. The same in which if a victim here feels like they're reputation has gone through the mud enough that we don't force them to still defend themselves, especially when character attacks are a thing in trial, ladies and gentlemen. Ma'am. So there's a distinction now. On our side, if a person chooses to go to trial because they think there is a collective good, that person can go. But if they don't want to, you don't account for that because you force them. Lastly, that it impedes other objectives in life. You sue someone on defamation because your reputation is important. So you could be a politician that wants to push for policies surrounding women or education, or you could be a rights activist pushing for things like transgender rights. What happens when you have a trial that is overblown is that oftentimes it drags all of your other objectives through the mud, and people conflate your identity or your presupposed attack to your other general agendas that exist in status quo. That's why we were very happy to have individuals like Nurul Izzah and Utusan settling their suit out of court, because we acknowledge there are other good efforts that she's working on rather than forcing her, because we think character attacks are unbecoming.
Yes.
Look, in civil cases, it is still up to the plaintiff to file it or not. So if the plaintiff feels that it derails their objective, they won't. But this debate talks about in the event that they already want to go to court.
Okay.
How do you protect the journalists writing up articles on corrupted individuals from being intimidated into taking private
settlements? When individual files a claim, it does not mean that the individual wants to go to court. That's why we have things like alternative methods of dispute resolution. You have arbitration. You have reconciliation. You have discussions rather than going through court. That's why options are there's a myriad of options that is presented to the individual. That's why when you are filing a suit, you go talk to your lawyer. Your lawyer asks you, what do you really want to achieve out of this? Do you want to take this to trial, or do you want to sit down, make them face you, and make them apologize? These are distinct services or things that we allow under the law. We don't think that you always want to go to court. Secondly, defendants. We don't think that defendants often have to act out of genuine concern and altruism in trying to deal with this resolution. So if a person feels that I can make this go away by paying X amount of money, we think that should be an option that is allowed to them as well. Especially when the person does not want a public record of the negligence or the intentional wrongdoing that they were talking about, ladies and gentlemen. Under our world, the back and forth that government was talking about dies out because no one is granting legitimacy, because no one is really talking about it. Rather than when you have a court trial that drags it out, that attacks people, that points them to a fault and say that one mistake makes you as an individual, we think it's far more problematic. Very proud to oppose.
Thank you, Jay. To end the case on side government, let's have on stage the government whip.
Hello, everyone hear me? Okay. For far too long have poor people been spectators in the theatres of their life. For far too long have they allowed rich manipulative politicians and corporations to tell them that they do not need to go to court to seek justice. The position of the government team was pretty simple. In a world dictated by money, as much as possible, we should minimize it. Probably in a court case, it's unfair. Probably you're going to work up against richer lawyers, but that is nothing, Mr. Speaker, in comparison to working against money outside of court where you have to sign a non-disclosure agreement. Before I go on to two issues in this debate, who better protects the poorer individuals, and in which world is the truth more likely to come out, I'd like to make a clarification on what this debate actually is about. Apparently, this debate was only about smaller politicians being defamed by smaller people. Because it's obviously true, you need a reputation in order to be defamed. Great, we will also defend that. In a world in which politicians are defamed by people, supposedly, we would say we would rather them go to court. Because the comparison is, in your world, that poorer person would have to fork out huge amounts of money to have an out-of-court settlement. We would rather this person go to court, probably give reasons why he was not defaming a politician, which often is the case, right? Politicians accuse smaller people of defaming them, but they're not actually doing it. At the point at which we bring them to court, maybe the politician will take back his need to sue for defamation, because it's often a political scheme anyway. But this debate is also about the converse, right? A lot of time, corporations and politicians defame average people like you and I. They say, we want this policy in our neighborhood. Oh, a lot of people are in favor of this. This person actually supported our policy, which is hugely defamatory to my reputation. It might not be as big as a politician, but the reputation is scarred anyway. So we say there are equal amounts of people harmed by corporations and corporations who are also harmed by people. Two questions in this debate. In which world are poor people in a better position? The first question we must ask is, are they really making a choice? Because they say you don't owe an obligation to future individuals. You don't owe an obligation to people who are potentially victims. Of course you do, Mr. Speaker. You are literally complicit in other individuals having to start from scratch if they want to file a defamation suit against a corporation. They won't have information to work on. They won't have precedent to work on. They won't even have any information about the corporation's work. To start from zero every single time is being complicit in a cycle where people are pressured into private settlements, not by your family only, but by also the fact that you have to start from ground zero. That is a world in which you are complicit and probably negligent, right, to the suffering of other individuals. Don't say people don't have an obligation to others. The second question, a second part of this, is that they say individuals are more likely to lose in a court trial process. All right, we will say a couple of things to this. The first thing we will say is, as much as possible, we'll try to make the field equal. That can include things like having pro bono lawyers who will probably take up this case because it's a really high profile case. Things like increasing the amount of revenue the state spends on public defense, all those things can happen. They're not mutually exclusive. But it's true, powerful lawyers probably have a better capacity in court to fight against the system. But a powerful lawyer, as you all know, has to work within the realms of the law anyway. So as good as he can be, he's only working within the realms of what is legal. So how far is this manipulative private lawyer going to be in comparison to a private settlement where there's no one to adjudicate it, there is no judge, there is no jury? What kind of justice is that? So we agree, you're more likely to lose a court process, but in the pursuit of that court process, a lot of information will come out, precedents might be set, and in that pursuit, there will be witnesses that people can refer in the future for other cases. So it's not so much about the verdict, but rather the process in which we achieve information in a court. But the second thing they say is, it's time sensitive. If we do not give people the closure they want to, then it's probably worse off for them. Let's talk about the value of this closure, right? Because the point at which there's a private settlement and you cannot speak about it, and politicians have a monopoly over the media, a monopoly of how they represent you rather than the converse, that is a world in which your time sensitivity seems so small compared to a world where you cannot speak up about an issue, where you cannot refer to a court process to say, I spoke in court and I am a victim. What world will you ever be able to call yourself a victim if you cannot speak about information? So we don't think time sensitivity is part of this debate. Before I go on to my second question, yes.
Private settlements aren't shady backdoor deals. You have a person appointed by the court to mediate and arbitrate. Why isn't this enough to act out fairness in that discussion?
I don't get it. First, you say private lawyers are going to manipulate the system, but that you want that system to adjudicate closure. Which one is it? Do you want people to have full closure that is independent of a court process, or do you actually think the court is fair? And then in our world, it'd probably be better when we have a verdict, right? The second thing, in which world would truth come out more? It is apparent truth, sensationalization will be worse in their world. We will say this is the comparative. Either way, corporations are going to speak about an issue based on opinions, based on speculative facts. At least in our world, the victim can refer to a court case and it can refer to evidence and witnesses' testimony that is accurate and representative. The sensationalization in our world will at least be premised on facts. The sensationalization in your world will be premised on money and lobbying and a persuasion of who is more likely to tell that story. So great, the Zionist propaganda that you say is such a big problem, in your world, it won't even be backed up by facts. It will just go uncontested. At least there is some contention in our world. That's the comparison. But the second thing he says is, well, there are court processes and there's a backlog of cases. I really have a problem with this. If you think we need more courts, I don't think that's a problem. We will pump more money into the court system. Rich people, we'll tax them greater. Stop funding money into like building power plants. We'll just have more court processes. If there are too many cases and you say there are programs to fix that, we will also employ those exact same programs because it's so important. To say that some cases are not worth going to court for is to say that some cases and some victims just don't deserve the same amount of justice. But the last thing in question in relation to this issue is about whether or not it's your personal choice and whether or not people can coerce you into a settlement. The fact that you are going to go for a private settlement means you're probably geared up for a trial. Because if the threat wasn't so great, no one was going to offer you a private settlement, right? No corporation is going to fork out $500 million for someone who is a fake person, right? So at that point, we think that person, instead of gearing up and pretending like you're not going to go to trial, might as well go to trial. And at that point, that person will achieve somewhat better closure than in your world. Money cannot account for the future victims that this corporation will create. Money cannot also account for the amount of like negligence that this corporation will go uncontested in your world. At least in our world, if there's a problem, we will fix loopholes in that law. If there's a problem, we can fix it. So the next person who goes to court will have an easier time maybe winning. So for every 10 people we send to court, those 10 people will have a hard time. But at some point, the last defendant will plaintiff will probably have enough information to go to court and win against that big corporation.
Thank you, Amrit. Now for the final 7-minute speech, I'd like to invite the opposition whip.
I think this debate needs an injection of reality. It could not be more idealistic for the speaker before me to say, hey, if you need more courts, you just build more courts. You know, if we want more money, we'll just tax rich people. You try tell a rich person that their money will be used to build courts that they want to prosecute them. So I really think we have to pick and choose the way we look at this debate. And I think this side needs to be a little bit more realistic for today. So in my speech, I'll address a couple of things. The first thing I'll say is I think we are forgetting that there are victims in this debate. And oftentimes, it's very easy to say that a person that is prolific with a lot of money in a company that he probably owns or she probably owns is the villain. And oftentimes, it is very difficult for us to distinguish who should be punished and who should be rewarded. And it is very clear from this side that the person in the suit is always the villain. We disagree. We think that there are individuals that live prolific lives, that grew up putting all their hard-earned minute and dollar into building a future that a single article can take down. And this dismisses a couple of analyses that side opposition told you, that sometimes it's about managing your crises. So if you don't want to bring it to court, and if you don't want people to talk about it, you've got to shut it down. That's just pure, simple strategy. You don't want it to blow up. You don't want more information to get out there. So you just want to settle it in a room with a court-appointed mediator. Have a seat. Sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, this may not always be the most righteous thing to do, but it is the most strategic thing to do. Because the media will pick it up. The media will savagely crucify you because it sells. And scandal always sells. They say if there is information, at least the person can adjudicate the ratio decidendi of the decision. Come on. If you're a person, if you're a lay person, you never read any law book in your life, you would not be interested in any of the details they say would be really convincing. We'd likely think that they would just read the headline and throw the paper away. This is why newspaper companies don't care for the detail. They don't care for the facts. They don't care for the data. So even if it's available, it's not going to happen. But what will happen instead? We think what will happen instead is people will pick and nitpick on issues that will dramatize, that will sensationalize, and will crucify one party in that room. And hey, they say one party is always the poor person. Let's take this characterization that they say and let's think about it. So they say, if you go to court or if you're in this room, this rich person with a huge amount of resources, big law firms, got entire floors dedicated to interns, right? And they like pump like hours. You just go and you just flood the other side with a lot of cases, with a lot of material. They'll never be able to compete. The problem I have with this, I think it's true. I think it's so regrettable, unfortunate. Wow, we should stop it, but we can't. Right? So when you go to court, none of this changes. Like, they will hire experts to sit in the courtroom to tell you how people are reacting to body languages. They will tell you what to pay attention to. They'll tell you how to dress, how to react, how to nod, in what position should your leg face. All these things happen more in the court. Do you realize that? That it doesn't go away. The power, the influence, the authority, the corruption does not go away. But even if it does, even if somehow I'm in a courtroom and I'm so like overwhelmed with the respect I must have for the court now, they say there are corrupted people in power. Ooh, the amount of judges I can name that should not judge or adjudicate because they are simply just, you know, less respectful to the law. It's unfortunate. So you guys say go to court, no corruption. We disagree. We think in a situation where they will go to court and they are just judges that are more likely to come from the same university your rich defendants are from Oxbridge, they're white, they're male, they're educated. Who do you think the court is going to, you know, side with? I think they're going to side with their best friend because, hey, maybe a contract's coming. Yep.
In your world, don't you also want the courts to adjudicate your private settlement?
Yeah. So, you see, there's a problem here. We address that there is an issue. We think that magnitude of harm is lesser on this side than it is. Debates are not about absolute existences, but rather on the scale of how harmful something is. But let's not forget, all of those things that you just POI'd is in absence of a media sensationalization. Because you know what they tell us? And this is really interesting. They say, if the media doesn't have information, they'll just make up the information. Here's Media 101, guys. If they don't have affirmation of certain information, the news will just die out, right? Under your side, you would have affirmation, conviction. You don't even have certainty that this person, the innocent person, will be granted like money they deserve. Possibly, according to my analysis earlier, about people that are close networked with judges, you probably have convictions working against you as well. In these circumstances, Siron, not only will the court not side with your poor innocent person, but the media will vilify you and there will be no return. Have a seat, right? Actually, I'll take Amrit.
Yeah, so in both scenarios, there are privileged white people from Oxford Brookes. In your world, it's in the closed backdoor alleys where they'll decide a private settlement. Why not be in the real world where people can adjudicate their verdict?
First thing wrong with that, there are no privileged people from Oxford Brookes, only Oxford. But, ladies and gentlemen, I think there are a couple of things to note here, yeah? Time sensitivity. So, the analysis that is required here is that it's about how do we place individuals to best defend themselves. And I think this is key in this debate. Because according to her, we'll just build a court, right? So more courts, in one district, there'll be one court. So everyone can... We don't think that's realistic. If it was realistic and if it was true, it would have already happened. Unfortunately, people don't care for that. So what's most likely going to do is going to delay the justice that people will get. And by that time... it'll be too late for you to recover from any damages you would have. There's a really good movie. Meryl Streep acted in it. It's called Doubt. And she's got a really good analogy in that movie. So she says, if you take a pillow, a feather pillow, and you go up to the ceiling, and you release all the feathers into society, into like the air, it will be almost impossible for you to pick up each and every one and put it back in the pillow. That's exactly what these guys are doing. When you create doubt and you release it, that is almost impossible for you to put every single one of those sins back into Pandora's box. We say people can choose. People can choose and people can decide, even if they're manipulated. It's a far better world to live in when people can make choices about their own fate and destiny. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Siron. We will now move on to reply speeches. We will hear first from side opposition.
Ladies and gentlemen, I like to think of myself as being a funny individual. People may or may not agree, but I like to believe that. But I think there was someone funny in this room because it needed the government whip to come in at whip to introduce mechanisms to solve certain problems in the debate, right? And I think that that acknowledges the fact that they don't really know what they want. They don't know who they're talking about, and they have no clear outcomes in this debate. So let's make a comparative. On government, on the smallest of chances, on a probability that they never even mentioned, and I didn't need them to because I don't really like math, but because on a small probability, a poor person might win a case, we remove the option for everyone. We said on opposition that the option exists because justice seeks to ensure equality, but justice also accounts for accommodating individuals for what they want and what options and what choices do they want. That's why the law is beyond a point of having a one-size-fits-all solution. That's why we don't apply a blanket punishment to everyone. That's why we don't give everyone the same amount of money when harm comes to them, ladies and gentlemen. So let's talk about two things. One, which side better helps people? Let's acknowledge that in status quo, when you go to trial, guilt hasn't been determined. But government already ascribed guilt because you are a big, bad, rich corporation. You are evil. You are always going to manipulate people, force them to accept money, and you are always guilty. And that's why we say trials are unpredictable, because defamation includes things like innuendos. And if there's objective resolution and it is concluded that that defamatory statement did not come to anything, it means that the person who is making that complaint will not get anything right now, or the plaintiff will not be able to get that resolution. That's why we are okay with alternative methods of dispute resolution, things like arbitration, reconciliation, and discussion. It's not a coffee shop discussion or like a back alley discussion like they like for you to believe, right? These methods are an extension of the court, but here's the distinction. It is exclusive because it is private, because individuals within the settlement gets to control at what point do I talk about my decision, at what point do I decide when my suffering ends, ladies and gentlemen. I'm a law student. My pointer isn't so great, so I won't say it. But I know at least that the law accommodates individuals to say that there are options in which you can engage in the law. And that's why we have things like different methods in which you talk to your lawyer and what you want to achieve, rather than your lawyers telling you, go to court, we can win it, even though, you know, I may be tired, I have a lot of cases because I'm a pro bono lawyer that is altruistic in nature and I want to do everything for you and I want to win everything for you as well. But we also think that my hurt shouldn't be made an example for people, because they say precedents can exist. We would say that just because you have private settlements doesn't mean everyone will engage in private settlements. Some people do want to go to trial, and that's great for them, they can be that precedence. Sensationalizing, they say that it's about facts versus persuasion. We don't think so. We think that at this point, if you have a private settlement, no one is really saying anything. No one is confirming particular biases. The media may make things up, that these stories are likely to die out because no one is actually going forward and saying, yes, I am Mr. X in this article. Yes, I am the owner of this hotel who had the camera in that room, ladies and gentlemen. That's why we think it is more important that at least plaintiffs get to determine the control in which they want to exit in that situation, rather than saying, because on the off chance one person who is poor might win, that I don't get that option. Secondly, on defendants, listen, sometimes people say things they may mean, things they may not mean. And sometimes it can be taken out of context. Sometimes it can be vitriolic in nature, ladies and gentlemen. What we would think is that when you are making up for that fault, that we do not need to test for genuine concern, genuine humility, and genuine taking an absolute apologetic position. It is enough for you to opt for the option to make up for that fault via settling in a private settlement, because we think at least you also get to protect your reputation, you also get to protect your position, and at this point, resolve that conflict rather than letting it drag out to the ends of the corner for everyone to talk about over teh tarik and roti canai, ladies and gentlemen. Very proud to have entertained you all.
Thank you, Jay. We will now hear the reply speech from side government.
Ladies and gentlemen, in a world that is dictated by money and in a world that is plagued by corruption, we need to ensure that we have the avenue to talk about it, and in the event that there is false information out there, that we bring it to court so that we can validate or invalidate that information, so that we create a much more fruitful discussion in order for individuals to be able to have meaningful conversations about how we improve our state that we are in. In my speech, I will answer two questions. Number one, who better provides closure for individuals? Number two, how do we protect the less privileged in defamation cases? Number one, who better provides closure? Opposition says it's them, because they make it all go away. They give you money, you shut up, and all our problems are solved. Making it go away and shutting up people with money sounds very familiar, because it sounds like a court-endorsed form of corruption that allows for privileged individuals to intimidate you into silence and to not allow the society or the court that is, we would like to believe, have room to make legitimate decisions to dictate the truth and the value of what happened between these individuals. We think money without truth and without transparency wins in your world the point at which you allow for out-of-court settlements. Going to court explicitly for defamation cases where you can clear your name, where you can give true information to society, this is what true closure really is. We think that in that case, you are able to validate the truth of an argument, of an article, or of an accusation. We think that's what creates a much more meaningful society. But number two, how do we protect the less privileged in defamation cases? They told us, well, it's when you allow out-of-court settlements. Because if you're worried about corruption, going to court, reality is the court is also corrupted, to which we think is a contradiction. Because this is the very same court you want to adjudicate your private settlements as well. They try to mitigate it and tell you, yeah, well, at least it's out of the media, so it's kind of better we're protecting these individuals. So if you allow the corrupted courts to make this decision away from the eyes of society, away from the eyes of the entity that I mentioned in my primary speech of like independent individuals, of organizations that are anti-corruption, of media that can scrutinize your cases, you mean to tell me that that's going to be a much more transparent form of transaction? I just simply don't believe that. Number two, they told us that they save individuals from media because media tends to sensationalize and they just don't care about facts. They just love to write up about things. And then later on in Siron's case, they told you, no, but if they don't have information because suddenly they care about facts, they won't write it, right? So we think in our world, you can't stop the media from writing. That happens in both scenarios. You can't stop the media from writing. But at least in our world, you have an avenue of what amounts to true information that allow an individual to come up, that allows an individual to come up and say what I said was true or what the other person said is true or not. We think that is what is more important. But thirdly, we think that the information that is a byproduct of the court case is crucial information that studies the behavior of the manipulative. And this came out all the way from Prime Minister that was never engaged with. The reason why this byproduct information that is more than just the evidence of the defamatory statement itself, but rather how parties go about dealing in that cases, what sort of mitigating factors they invoke, what sort of arguments they bring up in court, is important because it is used for you to later on improve the law, for you to change the law, for you to enforce the law better. And the reason why this is important is because if the law can be changed, and if it can be better enforced, it means in the long run, you get individuals to get justice, even if they have less experienced lawyers because they can't afford more experienced lawyers because the law will be on your side. What we never heard from their side of the house is how do they improve situations to ensure that smaller individuals don't get intimidated into shutting up, especially when some of the things that they have to say is things that would make all of the difference to individuals like you and I. Thank you.
Thank you, Ameera. Debaters, please cross the floor and shake hands. This will prevent any form of defamation suits coming out from one another.
Good afternoon, everyone. If nothing else, you'll get used to my New Zealand accent. We've been very fortunate this afternoon to have such a high quality of debating from these young, talented debaters who are also clearly very experienced. So I enjoyed the quality of the debate enormously, especially when it's on such a timely topic that this House would ban private settlements in defamation suits. I think everybody knows in this room that this is a very timely and controversial thing because of a number of issues that are going on in this country at the moment. So it's great pleasure that I'm here because this is an important organization, Transparency International, and the topic is important. I'd like to start, first of all, by talking about the matter, the manner and the method, but I will apply the KISS principle. I'll keep it short and sweet. The government's argument essentially looked quite a lot at the kind of oppressive thing that could happen. And the case was laid out very strongly about the smaller people versus the rich. And so in this case, we looked at the tool that can happen in terms of private settlements in defamation. So we had a lot of issues to do here with it as a tool for oppression and a case where you have the argument of the rich and the powerful versus the less rich and powerful. And the opposition was instead arguing for something else, which is very important in a democracy and very important everywhere, which is the role of choice, and argued that it shouldn't be a case of one size fits all, and that there should be a wider choice. There were a number of very strong arguments that were made. And so we have the whole big challenge going on where if we're going to change the narrative, to quote one of the speakers, we have to look very much at what is happening with private settlements in defamation suits. There are a number of interesting ways of approaching the term defamation as well. So I think you were aware that you were kind of coming at it at quite different angles at some times. And at a certain point, actually, the debaters, you were not actually touching on common ground. Yeah? I'd like to now briefly, because you've got to keep it brief because it's Saturday afternoon, turn a little bit to your manner. I think we saw very strong beginnings to all of the presentations. So you've all got very good hopes at getting the audience in. However, I would say there are a number of speakers who have such a lot to say that it got all really a bit speedy at times. You really want to look at the pacing and think of variety in what you're doing because sometimes some of you were going at about this pace. So this is a thing when you are, in fact, presenting your argument. And that, of course, is the challenge of debating, is to prune it down to the essential points. And so I feel that in terms of the delivery mode, that some of the debaters, who are very, very passionate people, aren't they? You could feel that. You're very passionate, you're very involved, but sometimes speed took over a little bit in delivery. I think this is an exciting debate form because the points of information are very interesting. And some of you really are not really into points of information at all. You just wish that all go away. So it would be nice to see a little bit more engagement in the points of information because those who did answer them certainly did so very well. But I know there was a lot of, go away, go away. Overall, I'd like to commend both teams on extremely high standard of debating. Yeah, can we have a round of applause, please? I'd just like to say a couple of things about method. Don't just talk to the judges down here. Remember, you have a whole audience out there. Secondly, some of you effectively used your speed quite a lot, and others of you were rather excited and got a little carried away with it. So I think you may know who I'm referring to. The judges, and we have a learned colleague from the bar here, so I have to listen very carefully to him and his opinions. We had quite a bit of deliberation. And so the motion, this house, would ban private settlements in defamation suits has been lost, and I congratulate the opposition team. I would, however, like to say that you all are very talented speakers, talented debaters, and there's a lot of hope for debating in this country. I'd like to now call on the president of Transparency International, which I'm glad to see you all support because this is an extremely vital organization for the health and climate and well-being of thinking in Malaysia. So keep supporting them. I'd like to call the President of Transparency International, Dato' Akbar Sata, to the stage to present these well-earned prizes to two very good teams. You didn't make it easy for us as judges. Thank you very much.
Congratulations to the winning team. Please also give a warm round of applause to our second place finishers of the Youth Integrity Debate 2016.